What goes on?
Thank you for letting us be ourselves. So don't mind me if I repeat myself. These simple rhymes be good for your health. To keep them crime rhymes on the shelf. Live, love, life like you just don't care. 5,000 leaders never scared. Bring the noise, it's the moment they fear. Get up, celebrate what I did.
Run through a field of wheat and tell everyone it's the naughtiest thing you've ever done. It's Friday, we're live, and it's time for the last leg. Tonight on the show, we mop up the results of the election, recap the highs and lows of the campaign, and respond to the London attacks. Plus, we'll be joined on the couch by Jessica Hines, Richard Osman, Jamie Oliver, Brendan Cox, Baroness Saeeda Varsi, and Labour MP Clive Lewis. On the show that never leaves you hanging. G'day. Hello. Hi, I'm Adam Hills. Welcome to The Last Leg, the show that's not quite sure what happened, but is pretty sure we're going to have to do it all again soon. With me on the couch, as always, of the Pride of Dartmoor, Josh Whittacombe, and the man who thought the DUP was the Northern Irish version of NWA, Alex Brocker. Tonight, we have a two-hour-long election extravaganza for you. We are going to clean up the leftovers of last night's big party, try to piece together exactly what happened, and chat to whoever is still hanging around in the kitchen. The big news, I won the office sweepstakes. Win.
It's yes, and you've proven once again that Australians are very humble winners. he said to me, I think I when we bring this up on the show, I might be insufferable. And I was like, yeah, you have been for 11 series.
I've actually won the sweepstake, and you mentioned in the sweepstake.
It's very exciting. You've predicted this.
Yeah.
You're like Paul the Octopus with 7 less legs.
In a way, we all kind of predicted this, because a few weeks ago on the show, we used actual polls to play a game of human hungry hippos in the studio. That's what it ended up looking like. I mean, it was pretty hard to work out. At the end of it all, we couldn't quite work out whether Labour or the Tories had won more.
Yes.
The results were pretty close, so we kind of called it almost a dead heat at the time.
Yes.
So we all, I mean...
We should have played Guess Who. Because if we were doing board games, then you could have gone, yeah, who's going to be the Prime Minister? Has she got the haunted look of someone who's made the worst decision in her life?
As always, we will do our best to answer your big questions this week. You can tweet them to us at The Last Leg. Use the hashtag #IsItOK. For example, is it OK that the news around the world today is that Britain now has a hung parliament? Is it OK that someone's going to have to explain to Donald Trump that a hung parliament isn't what he thinks it is? Of course, the big story is the election result, and the winner is a hung parliament. Ruth Watkinson said, is it OK that I'm waiting until the guys on the last leg to help explain the hung government? The grammar's not great, but then she says, that's after my 12-hour nursing shift. So, understandably, she was knackered.
No excuse, mate. No excuse at all. I saw, like, the Victoria Derbyshire from the BBC earlier.
Yep.
She tweeted how to explain a hung parliament to a 10-year-old.
Yeah.
And I read it all the way through, and at the end of it, I just thought... Well, I hope she's got something for 6-year-olds here, because I'm...
It was really confusing. You tried to... It was like some basketball terminology.
Some basketball analogy. It was a load of shit.
Yeah. I mean, you can't... This basketball analogy is not ideal for you, Alex, but, Oh, sorry.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my God. Maze Britain has turned.
I know.
If you don't like that, you're going to hate the next 2 hours.
Yeah. Do you want to explain?
Okay, here's my explanation. Or have you got a...
No, I've heard.
So in order to form a government and get laws passed, you need over half the seats in Parliament. Now, although the Conservatives got more seats than any other party, they didn't get halfway. So now they have to join forces with someone else. It's basically what happened in 2010, except this time the Lib Dems said, yeah, but nah. Laurie Pink said, is it OK that Adam's sign for hung Parliament also happens to be the British Sign Language for bollocks? It's because last time I went like this, and apparently...
Is that the British Sign Language for bollocks?
I guess, yeah.
I've got something seriously wrong with me, if that's what it... The way to I understand a hung parliament is because the Conservatives just missed the majority.
Yeah.
You know, like when you're in a newsagent and you can't quite make the £5 minimum on a card.
Yeah.
The DUP are that packet of chewing gum.
Theresa May has said she will still provide.
Could have done with this a few hours ago.
In about a month, Theresa May is going to find the DUP at the bottom of her bag and go, I remember that!
Theresa May says that despite the hung parliament, she will still provide certainty for the nation. And the sign for that sentence is bullshit. It was a terrible night for Theresa May. The poll predictions had ranged from a hung parliament, according to YouGov, to a guy called Ian Dale, who's the former chief of staff to David Davis, who predicted a 122-seat majority to the Conservatives. This was the exciting moment we found out whose prediction was closer.
And what we're saying is the Conservatives are the largest party. Note, they don't have an overall majority at this stage. 314 for the Conservatives. That's down 17. 266 for Labour. That's up 34.
I say exciting.
I got goosebumps watching that.
Did you?
Yeah.
How did you feel at the time?
Well, obviously, we've not been allowed to say our political allegiance during the election period.
Yes.
But I would say that I stayed up till 3:30 last night and it was the best 5.5 hours of my life. No, it was amazing.
Alex, on the other hand, devastated by UKIP's losses.
The election cost £130 million, and I'd say it was worth every penny for what I experienced.
I didn't really see, like, when that happened, because I was watching Love Island. And I was thinking, Harley's had an absolute stinker tonight. And I saw that and thought, actually, no, Theresa May is absolutely... But I don't like exit polls, cos I don't see the point in spoilers. Find out in the morning.
As the night unfolded, it became clear that the exit poll was pretty accurate. By about 2 a.m, the fourth most searched question on Google was, who is the Prime Minister? Google asked Siri, Siri asked Jeeves, and no one seemed to know the answer.
Oh, come on. No one's searching for who's the Prime Minister at 2 a.m. That's what you say to your mum when she asks you why you're on the computer at 2 a.m. The fifth most search was, will it make me go blind?
As Labour mopped up more of the UKIP votes than was expected, Jeremy Corbyn's mode went from happy to ecstatic while Theresa May won her seat but looked like she was falling on her butt. As dawn broke, Jeremy Corbyn was the toast of the town, appearing above the obligatory Corbyn pun.
That is a face of a man who's about to get absolutely wankered, isn't it? I half wanted to see pictures of him this morning, face down in his allotment, pint of homebrew in one hand, cuddling a fox in another.
Well, Theresa May made another speech today that noticeably didn't even mention the heartbreak of the previous night.
This will allow us to come together as a country and channel our energies towards a successful Brexit deal that works for everyone in this country, securing a new partnership with the EU which guarantees our long-term prosperity. That's what people voted for last June. That's what we will deliver. Now let's get to work.
It was a bizarre. It was like she hadn't heard the result yet. She's gone, I've taped it, no one tell me, I'm just going to do the speech. It was weird, because, like, she didn't mention it. I, because of all the U-turns she's done, I was half expecting her to go, there was never an election.
She was trying to put a brave face in it so much. It kind of reminded me of, like, if your parents get divorced and they sit you down and tell you that nothing's going to change. Like, she just basically stopped short of telling the country, at least you get, like, two lots of presents at birthdays and Christmas. Your uncle DUP's going to move in for a bit. Adam and Steve can't come round anymore.
You know when, like, David Cameron resigned and he walked back into the... and they'd kept his mic up and he went, do-do-do-do-do, right.
Yeah.
I wish they'd kept her mic up just to hear her walk back in and go, do-do-do-do-do, fuck!
Kim Welsh said, is it OK that in our fight against extremists, Theresa May has jumped into bed with a group of extremists? Now, the only people willing to help out the Conservatives right now are a Northern Irish party called the Democratic Unionist Party, also known as the DUP. Yeah, you know me. just can't say it without saying that bit. Ironically, their slogan is Standing Strong. The DUP were founded by the Reverend Ian Paisley in 1971. They have had links to terrorism in the past. They are anti-abortion, against same-sex marriage, and a number of their senior members are creationists who believe God created the world and everything in it a few thousand years ago. Basically, they're the only people in the world who think the movie Footloose had an unhappy ending.
It's weird, isn't it? Because they've got those views and obviously... is it Arlene... I can't
Arlene Foster.
Arlene Foster and Theresa May obviously have partnered up, which the DUP are very much against.
Tell you what.
Yeah.
Gay foxes are absolutely screwed, aren't they?
It's kind of like Theresa May needed a lift to Glastonbury, but a car broke down, so now she has to hitch a ride with her old homophobic uncle that won't let her listen to the music. Oh, and some of the DUP like to dress up like this.
And whoa, that looks like a kind of butler cycling proficiency test.
given their views, I mean, those sashes are fairly camp, aren't they?
I think we just found the welcoming committee for Donald Trump. They're conservative, they're anti-abortion, and they are orange men. Now,
that was a great joke, and it deserved more.
I think... Thanks. Do you know what I think tonight? I think we're going to find out how much angrier DUP supporters are than UKIP supporters. at the moment, we don't know if they're going to form an official coalition with the Tories or do something that's called confidence and supply, which is... It's not a coalition, it's a little bit more casual.
So, kind of like friends with benefits. Well, I mean not benefits if it's the Tories. They fucking hate all that, but...
So they're going to be like, so Theresa May's going to be like phoning them up at midnight going, are you still awake?
It basically means that they're not an official coalition, but they will help out if need be to get bills passed. Tonight's poll, by the way, though, what should the new coalition be called? The DUP and the Conservatives together. Tweet us at the last leg. Use the hashtag coalition names.
More May, less gay.
Yeah.
That's also what you wrote on your voting slip, isn't it?
Stuart asked, is it OK that this should now be the Tories' theme tune and linked to the song Fields of Gold? Now, that's because when Theresa May was asked for the naughtiest thing she had ever done earlier in the week, she replied with this unprepared and underwhelming answer.
Oh, goodness me. Well, I suppose the... gosh. Do you know? I'm not quite sure.
Well, there must have been a moment.
Nobody's ever perfectly behaved, are they? I mean, you know, I have to confess, when me and my friends sort of used to run through the fields of wheat, the farmers weren't too pleased about that.
That is not the naughtiest thing she's ever... The naughtiest thing she's ever done is sell arms to the Saudis.
I think you're slightly confusing naughty with terrible for humanity.
I'm going to say right now, this coalition is not going to work between the DUP and the Conservatives, and I'll tell you why. In 2011, a DUP councillor famously threw the pop star Rihanna off his farm while she was filming a video clip because she was wearing inappropriate clothes while writhing around in his wheat field. We're going back to the polls in 2 weeks, people. Another 130 million up the spout. And do you know what? I quite enjoyed voting yesterday.
Did you?
I quite like voting over here. It's simple. In Australia, you have to number them all here. It's just one cross, you're out.
No, we're meant to number them. You fucked up, mate.
The only thing I miss, though, in Australia, there's a sense of community because there aren't the little polling stations. You go to the local school and there's a... Basically, you get a sausage sizzle when you vote in Australia. Yeah. You get what we like to call a democracy sausage.
Yeah, you've said about this before and I still don't believe you. You get given a sausage to vote?
Yeah, you buy...
We vote because we believe in democracy.
No, in Australia we have bunting, sausages and Peter Andre sings to you as you cast your vote. I mean, British people have now had more elections in the past 2 years than you've had successful barbecues. I missed it. That's the only thing I'm missing from this election special. So I'm going to put my desk into Australia mode.
You...
Is that real? Is that on?
Someone knows Jamie Oliver's coming on later.
Tell you what, you've been waiting 5 years to turn that desk into a barbecue, haven't you?
Well, it's been like this for 5 years.
Every time there's an advert break, he starts barbecuing.
And we have.
Have you got any veggie options?
Of course we don't. we did par cook some of these earlier.
How many sausages have you got?
We've got a whole stack down here. I'll leave the rest here. We've just got four for the moment, I guess.
And what, people get these if they...
Oh, just whoever... In Australia, you get it after you've voted. But I did check. I thought you got it for free, but I was corrected by a politician in Australia that said, no, you're not allowed to get them for free because it's not legally appropriate if a candidate gives you a free sausage for a vote.
Oh, no, I cast my vote for the wrong reason yesterday.
I'll tell you what, a sausage would have swung me.
Yeah, that's not the first time you've said that. all right, we have a whole cabinet of guests tonight, but to kick them off, would you please welcome an actress who appeared in the video for the Women's Equality Party and a comedian who was up all night on Channel 4's alternative election coverage, Jessica Hines and Richard Osman.
I did stand up to greet you, but that's your tiny mustard portion. I'm sorry.
Oh, you can have a bit more.
Just the sausage. Because I'm on like the diet at the moment, so.
Oh, you're off the. Would you like the sausage?
I think that's why Theresa might have lost the election.
I thought you were going to feed it to me.
I'm going to put it on a plate for you, Alex.
I'll be honest with you.
You don't want me to burn my hand and make it look worse, do you?
If there had been sausages available at our polling stations, I think Jeremy Corbyn's voters wouldn't have turned up.
Well, that's what I mean. Theresa likes wheat, kills animals.
Yeah.
And that's going to lose the young person's vote. I mean, no young person likes wheat or kills animals.
No, none of the kids are into wheat.
Nobody eats wheat.
They're wheat. They're wheat.
So the mentioning of the wheat, just that was it. Everything. Was
Alex,
over.
Are you OK over there?
These aren't properly cooked, are they?
I've definitely gone too early on it.
You might want to hand them back. Richard, have you had any sleep?
I had a little bit of sleep, yeah. I had a little bit of sleep. We were on till 6 in the morning. I was hallucinating at one point, I have to say. I hallucinated at about 5 in the morning that Theresa May hadn't resigned. No, it was an amazing night, an amazing day. Genuinely, probably the most extraordinary political own goal
history, I would say.
Of course, completely unnecessary election, cost us a fortune, absolutely took the electorate for granted, which is one thing you can never do. If you abuse democracy, democracy bites back, and it's exactly what's happened. So, a triumphant day, an extraordinary day, but also a very, very, very funny day.
Jessica, how did you feel? Sorry, I was just told.
I went to bed.
You went to bed?
Yeah, I kind of cynically, what? I thought, yeah, I did. I was like, I made a great big shepherd's pie. You know, which I thought, we'll never eat all this. And then we all ate all of it, like too much of it. Uh-huh. So it put us into a kind of food coma. So we were all kind of asleep with kind of shepherd's pie overload by about 9 in our house.
Yeah.
And then at 1, I was woken up by the shepherd's pie in that way you are when you eat too much. And I checked on my phone and it was like, OK, maybe I should have stayed up.
So that's the election explained. Right.
I didn't realise we'd booked the experts.
What was the atmosphere like where you were at 10 o'clock when the exit polls came out?
It was amazing. I mean, it's an extraordinary thing. I mean, we did this 2 years ago as well. I wasn't aware it was going to become a series, but it seems to be.
You've got another one in autumn.
Exactly. You know what? It's incredible. I think everyone was kind of, I think everyone was happy. Whatever political party you're from, I think the... I think the cynicism of the whole idea of having the election meant that finally, when you saw the result, you think, you know what, something's changed in this country.
Yeah.
And, you know, change, I think, given what's happening, is probably going to be a good thing. Look, it's another dead heat. Labour didn't win, the Tories didn't win, so, you know, we've got another mess ahead of us for the next sort of 6 months.
You're taking this really seriously, aren't you?
Well, yes. Given it's about the future of our country and our children. And, no, listen.
I woke up, I was like, it's chaos. And I just felt so at home. I was like, this is what it feels like to be British. Just like chaos. Yeah.
I have one question.
Like, great. What?
Is it, lamb or beef?
Oh.
In the pie.
Okay. Can I say, it's beef if it's cottage pie. Did I say shepherd's?
Cottage pie.
Sorry, it was a cottage pie. It wasn't shepherd's pie.
It was a cottage pie.
Oh, but sorry.
Do you know what? That changes everything for me.
When people said we were going to struggle to fill our two-hour special...
I'll just say that's already... We've been here 2 minutes. There's already a U-turn.
Richard, what did you make of Theresa May's performance today?
Honestly, I thought it was extraordinary. Yeah. I genuinely thought it was. The speech that she made, the sort of... when she was in her constituency, I thought was the most extraordinary thing I've ever heard. There was no humility in it whatsoever. There was no sense that she had done anything wrong, which, in my opinion, she had done. And she was still the gall to be able to say the only way you have stability is through me, I think is absolutely extraordinary. Yeah. You haven't had 6 weeks of saying we're going to have a coalition of chaos. We've got a coalition of chaos between her and the DUP. She has done that completely unnecessarily. None of us asked for it. Nobody did. She already had a majority. We voted for that majority. We put them in power to take us through Brexit. We gave them that. She wanted more. She's got less. And now she's got to sort the problem out. And she seems to think it's our problem. It's like she's driven her car into our house and she's got out and gone, what are you going to do about this?
I'll tell you... She'll be gone in 6 months, and I think in 20 years she'll be a pointless answer.
Do you know what?
You'll be on pointless, and you'll go, and the last one, Theresa May. Well done if you got that at home.
I don't think she's ever been more exposed. I think she's spent a long time very comfortable as an MP. I think she kind of came, you know, into the sort of leadership position almost kind of by default, and I think this campaign has, without her realising it, exposed her. She cannot hide. And I think that... I thought it was really interesting the fact that she's a kind of... She's a vicar's daughter, and I think that she is used to the sort of theatricality of authority. So she's used to there being kind of a front, and then you don't actually have to tell everybody what's going on. Right. And I think that actually in the position that she's in as Prime Minister, you can't get away with that. And then obviously Corbyn, who's the kind of opposite end of the spectrum, he just is literally TMI, too much information, constantly telling us how much he's going to raise the taxes by, to the point where you're going, Jeremy, you don't have to necessarily tell us, keep telling us how much you're going to do it, but he's like a pathological truth teller, you know, so you've got kind of two ends of the spectrum. It's like kind of Theresa ran through the wheat and he was there spying on her with binoculars. Knitted tank top, kind of going out of his way 5 miles on the way home to make sure the farmer knew that it happened.
I'll tell you what, I bet you Philip made sure those bins are out tonight.
Hardly any of the pollsters saw the result coming, but the signs were there for anyone who looked hard enough, because while Theresa May's strong and stable van fell over on a motorway during the week, on the other side of the world, a once-laughed-at underdog broke through from the pack and came from behind to win the day.
Supercharged in front, still too clear. Horsey McHorseface is out now. The big dream of back to the fence. And then followed Masking Lucky, Starlet and Chastity Strikes. The big dreamer got through on the inside. Supercharged quickly beaten. Horsey McHorseface is coming. Horsey McHorseface and the big dreamer. Horsey. Horsey McHorseface beats the big dreamer.
The signs were there, people. The signs were there. And listen, we're just hearing that Kensington, by 20 votes, has been declared for Labour. Do you know what? I've just realised we've ordered this show all about wrong. We've been talking about Theresa May and getting all down on her ass. No, let's talk about Jeremy Corbyn. Let's get some positivity back in the room. After the break. After the break. We'll be back with more of the Last Leg Election Special as we take a look at the Corbyn effect and some more May-splaining, and we'll chat to Labour MP Clive Lewis. We'll see you in a little bit. Welcome back to Last Leg Election Special, where we're still joined by Jessica Hines and Richard Osman. A couple of statistics for you from last night's election. There are now a record number of women MPs in Parliament in the UK.
32%.
Add to that,
eventually,
Labour
panel shows will catch up with Parliament.
Not if I've got anything to do with it.
Also, Labour have two disabled MPs that were elected last night as well.
Keep them in Parliament and off the telly.
It's Alex's new campaign. Dale said, is it OK that Corbyn ended up the better loser over May? Look, as rough as a night as it was for Theresa May, it was an absolutely cracking night if you're a Jeremy Corbyn supporter. The story of his election, and let's be honest, it didn't start particularly well. It literally started on the wrong foot as a car in which he was being driven ran over a photographer's foot.
The gap.
I mean, that is that is someone who is beeping their horn too late.
The worst thing for that guy is a car for Corbyn made him disabled, and a government by May means he's going to get sod all for it.
As things progressed throughout the campaign, he did start to look more comfortable, I think it's fair to say. He actually became the first politician in ages to eat food and look normal.
Jabby, you're the Pringle!
Yes, sir.
You're the Pringle!
I'm a Pringle, sir. There's a few here.
Yeah!
I said it last week, that's when it changed for me, because to eat one Pringle and stop. If Theresa May this week had have had a jam donut and not licked her lips, she'd have done a lot better.
I think, is it fair to say, I think his manifesto went down particularly well also?
The absolute masterstroke they did was, because, you know, he wasn't much loved at the start of the campaign, especially by older voters, is they leaked the manifesto, or it was leaked, which meant for a week people could look at the manifesto and they couldn't answer questions about it because they kept saying, wait a week and we'll tell you about it. Which meant for a whole week people just had to look at the policies by themselves without having to hear Jeremy give them, right. Which is a very, very clever thing to do. And then a week later, when everyone had gone, actually, there's some quite good stuff here. Actually, perhaps we should renationalise the railways. And then when Corbyn comes back in, he had a week of people going, we quite like that, Jeremy. That was the absolute masterstroke. That's what turned it for him.
He really played the social media well also. Just having a look at this, his Facebook page, during the time that he closed the gap on Theresa May, got more than 209,000 likes from British users, while hers only got 43,000. His account tweeted 675 times. Her account tweeted 72 times, which may explain why he ended up getting the younger vote, because he really worked the social media.
The perception really really changed, like, yeah. And I mean, to draw an analogy, there was another man with the initials JC, who wasn't very popular.
Yeah,
and then, you know, he built up and he changed the world, and that man was Jeremy Clarkson.
There were a lot of positive endorsements for him as well. Do you think those helped? Because there were people like, I mean, there was Leonard Dunham, Steve Coogan, Clean Bandit, Mark Ruffalo, Danny DeVito.
I think we were all waiting to see who Clean Bandit were aligning with. It was Clean Bandit what won it.
I think they don't help at all. I think every single person who tells you to vote for someone turns at least one extra person off.
Do you think?
Literally, never tell anybody to vote for someone. No one's interested. Nobody cares. What won it for? Well, of course, he hasn't won. What changed his popularity
was... What lost it by
less. What lost it by less was every election people say, you know, if young people went out and voted, you know you could actually make a difference. And the Tories assume that they won't because they never do. This time, they did. And that's what made the difference.
It was a wonderful thing. In my house, you know, my son's 18 and my niece is living with us at the moment. She's 19. You know, we all went to the... Well, my son went earlier in the day, but I went with my niece. So I've got two young people who voted for the first time in a general election in my house.
Yeah.
And it was great. They were really excited. And to feel that they actually made a difference, it meant something. It was a massive thing in their lives. And I think there's a lot of people who feel like that, that actually you can make an impact through democracy. And I think as well, you know, the fact that the Tories, their campaign was not good. Not good. I mean, that's an understatement. All they did was attack Jeremy, basically.
And he just did the positive stuff.
He got on Kerrang. He did not do that. He never, ever went for that. And people respond to that.
And also
he focused on his policies. He created policies that he believed in. You know, and again, perhaps he was almost too honest because he didn't even try and fudge it or cover up the fact that he was going to tax us all. Yeah. You know, he's like, no, 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 absolutely not. No, no, no. You know, which was almost to his detriment. But I think that young people who were very uncynical, they responded to that. They responded to his honesty and they responded to his passion, I think.
Well, 63% of the youth vote, of 18 to 24-year-olds voted for Labour. So he definitely did that. He was on the cover of Kerrang, he was on the cover of NME.
Yeah.
And the size of his crowds were amazing. He was in safe seats, but what it did was, by going to safe seats and being photographed with big crowds, it looked incredible. It looked like there was this huge movement behind him. By the end of the campaign, I mean, He didn't even need words to get a laugh.
And they announced that this was possible, that was impossible, and what we were doing, blah, 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 blah. No.
I mean, you know, you're going well when you can buzz that out. His night last night went so well, he even survived the world's most embarrassing high five.
Well, almost a victory party in Islington.
Best moment! Best moment of the entire night! Best moment of the night. All right, let's welcome our first political guest of the night. He's the Labour MP who won the seat of Norwich South last night and had the most joyous celebration of the evening.
I hereby declare that Clive Anthony Lewis has been duly elected. Yeah!
Did you plan that? Did it just come spontaneously?
Yeah, I sat in the mirror for a long time, kind of practicing how it would look. No, actually, what it was, what you don't really realise is that just before that, they'd told us that it was just 2 weeks till the pedestrianisation of Norwich City Centre was about to take place.
Yeah.
That's why I got so excited.
Alex has got one question that he's been dying to ask you.
Yeah, you postponed your honeymoon, didn't you? Well, so, was it worth it?
You sound like you're the person who's going on the honeymoon.
Was it worth it?
Well, my wife's in the audience, and I do know that if Theresa May, if there is another election, I will be getting divorced.
Here's a question for you. How much better do you think Jeremy Corbyn would have done if the party had really got behind him from the get-go?
It's like kind of what-if history. You can't say, but I think it's pretty clear to see that if people had got behind him from the outset and said, OK, let's give this a go, let's give you a fair crack of the whip, we could have done even better. I think that's obvious. But, however, we'll never know. But he's done what he's done, and I think what he turned around has been amazing. But if he had had more support from the PLP and the party, he might not have had the kind of underdog status. So
do you
just
don't
know.
Do you think the party will unite behind him now?
I think I was watching some of my colleagues who have been quite critical speaking about what had happened.
Yeah.
Some of them looked, it looked a bit awkward for some of them. But I think I'm expecting when we go into that PRP room, the vast majority of people will say, do you know what? I hope they will. But you know what? I think we were wrong in some aspects, in some respects of what we were saying about you and what we thought. And you've proven us wrong. And let's give us your full support. And let's try and get this Tory government and finish them off. Because at the moment, it feels like they've kind of crawled away into a dark space, like a horrible monster to kind of regenerate. And I think it just needs staking.
Do you think there'll be another election soon?
Because we really want to do another two-hour special.
I know loads about hung parliaments now.
I would think it's unlikely, would you not? Well, they would have to call it. I don't see it would be in their interest to call an election anytime.
No, I mean, there's also an argument to let her stew in her own juices. I mean, she's cooked this up.
Right.
She's cooked this up and, you know, let her stew. I mean, if you've watched Theresa May on TV, she's not someone that kind of brooks dissent, likes questions. And, you know, when she goes into... I mean, it's bad for all of us as a country because she's now been weakened for probably the most important set of negotiations since the Second World War. But Michael Barnier is just going to be going, ho, 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 when she walks in. So it's not...
Is
I don't think she's going to like
Father
it.
Christmas?
Because if very, very good news for us, isn't it?
Well, I don't know if she's been naughty or nice, if she's been running through those wheat fields.
No.
The press bias was in evidence for the last few days of the election, and if the newspapers were snakes, Jeremy Corbyn was the lone iguana that somehow got away from them all. In fact, there's a rumour that Rupert Murdoch actually stormed out of the room he was in when the exit poll results were announced.
He's 80. Oh. There's no way he could storm out of
it. I reckon what he did was disintegrate into dust and then reform on the other side of the door.
Well, he's been...
Okay.
He had been told half an hour beforehand, he'd been told it's a 60 majority, absolute minimum, by the Tories pollster. So that's what Murdoch, he's thinking, that's exactly what's happening. And he's a, presumably, if he's told 60, he's thinking 80, 90.
Was that person employed by him, do you think?
Well, he's employed by the Tory party, so, you know, indirectly.
That person is now missing.
The day before the election, The Sun ran with the front page, Jez's Jihadi Comrades.
I mean, not only did that not work, but it's also given him his dream team name for next season.
It sounds like the title of a Deirdre's photo case book.
Some of the claims they made may actually be illegal, by the way, but the day of the election, The Sun ran this front page.
But to be fair, I think he was an idiot to pose for it.
But, you know, that's, you know, in the olden days, people cared what was on the front cover of the newspapers because people bought newspapers. Now they don't.
Yeah.
You know, so that's meaningless. But I tell you what people did do is that got shared on social media hundreds of thousands of times, and that would have won an awful lot more votes for Labour than it would have won for the Tories.
I think that's a massive change as well with young people, is they now have... You have a generation of young people who have had a kind of masterclass in the propaganda of media. Mm. They're no fools, you know? And, exactly. And I think that's, you know, that's an incredible thing, you know?
Looks like the Cookie Monster from Sesame Street.
No,
would have gone down with the garbage monster.
Oscar.
Oscar. It's like an episode of Pointless, Richard.
Are you going
for Cookie Monster or Oscar the Grouch?
Oscar the Grouch.
Let's take a look, see if it's up there.
It's fair to say all this has put a spring in Jeremy Corbyn's step, and we reckon he should probably turn up to the first day of Prime Minister's questions like this.
Showtime. Let's go.
Here we go with more of the last leg of Leveson special as we work out where it all went wrong for Theresa May. Plus, we want to know what should the new coalition be called. Tweet us at the last leg, use the hashtag coalition names. We'll see you in a little bit. Last leg election special, which got its name, by the way, from a tweet we received a few weeks ago from Tom Stevenson, who is in the audience tonight. Tom Stevenson. We are joined by Jessica Hines, Richard Osman and Labour MP Clive Lewis. Here's the big question. What happened to Theresa May?
Well, I think... I was thinking about this earlier.
Was she in a field of wheat?
Yes. I was thinking about, I like Monty Python, and I was thinking she looked a bit like the Black Knight. It's just a flesh wound. It's just a flesh wound. And then she came out to make that speech.
Yeah,
no,
probably.
I'll bat
probably.
Your legs off.
But no, I just enough. Think. She...
Yeah.
But I think what she does. I think it's all been said many times before. She called an election that wasn't needed. I voted against it, not just because, as the Mail said, because it was my honeymoon.
Yeah.
And she
you also leader. Had a weekend away as well, didn't you? You had a great social diary.
It was a micro moon.
It was a
micro moon. That's what my wife calls it. A micro moon. Yeah.
Right.
That's what she
calls
it.
And she called it. And she called the election, and it's blown up in her face spectacularly. And the thing, the real.
Another political career gone in the last 24 hours.
Well, see, at the beginning of the campaign, she tried being human, and this happened.
She looks like she's... That should be a can of special brew, and it looks like she's just done 3 days at the trance tent at Glastonbury.
I've said it at the time, and I'll say it again. Who orders hot drinks with chips? What is your problem?
But also, the manifesto. Like, as much as you pointed out, Richard, the Labour manifesto was well-received. The dementia tax, or the so-called dementia tax, then the U-turn on the dementia tax, but Theresa May said it wasn't a U-turn, and then she looked really exasperated like this when she said it wasn't a U-turn.
Yeah. We
Nothing has changed. Nothing has changed. We are offering a long-term solution for the sustainability of social care for the future.
It's a flesh wound.
I'm still adamant they were fake arms.
But that is, that tone says, do you know what, you've got it wrong. You've got it, electorate, you've got it wrong. You don't understand. You know what, and that's not the tone to take with an electorate. If something happens to you, you've got to take it on the chin. You've got to accept, you know what, I got something wrong and take it. But you can't be called strong and stable for 2 weeks, do that and then start saying to the electorate, no, you don't understand. You simply haven't understood. Mm. Calling her strong and stable is what really, really fatally hold her, because she's not. It's like if I had the slogan, short with great eyesight, and I had to cry. You know, it's difficult.
And then, of course, she didn't turn up to the debates. Jess, that is the best impersonation. Again, can we just have... of course, she didn't turn up at the debates as well, saying that she preferred to meet the people. But... And that was her big tactic. Let's go out and meet the people. I'll go out and meet the people one-on-one. But here's the thing. Every marginal seat that Theresa May visited, she lost.
What do you reckon? I wanted her to come to... No, she came twice, so I'm putting that down to her. She does need a weapon.
There was somewhere she was there for 20 minutes. How could she... Do you think she smells?
Come on, guys, come
20
on.
20 minutes and she managed to turn everyone against her. Like, even Daphne and Celeste lasted longer than that at Reading Festival. Thought I got covered with piss.
What do you think... What's going to happen for her now? Is she going to stay? Do you think they're going to keep her there?
I think that the grandees in the Tory party, people in the Tory party, they're ruthless, they smell blood. Yeah. And I don't know whether she's going to last long term. I think, obviously, because of the negotiations, she'll have to stay for a certain amount of time. But the wolves are circling. They must be.
I was thinking, that's what he's going to kind of say, I'm going to save the day. You know, the mess he made is that kind of irony of, like, cometh the hour, cometh the man. Yeah. I wouldn't be surprised if he's thought of that slogan.
The simplest thing to do, I suspect, would be to give the leadership to David Davis, who's going to be right in the middle of those negotiations anyway, and would be a slightly better hand on the tiller for the Tories. But come an election, which at some point they have to hold, I think if you want to fight Corbyn, you've got to fight Corbyn probably with Boris Johnson, would you say? Somebody who, at least you go, you know what, you're both authentic. You're authentic in very different ways, I understand that. But at least, you know what, you're the person you come across as. And that, I have to say, would be
the
a hell of an election.
The irony of that. Would it?
Corbyn v Johnson? Oh, yeah.
I think if anything,
they should put that on pay TV, Corbyn v Johnson.
I'll tell you what, if that happens, you know what you're going to hear a lot of?
Thomas the Wank Engine.
Thing that comes out of his mouth. I mean, he set the whole kind of Brexit thing up. He didn't believe that they were going to go for Brexit. He did it to cynically win votes from people off UKIP, not thinking it was ever going to happen. And now we're in this mess. And if he actually then runs as a leader of the Conservative Party against Jeremy Corbyn, I don't believe anything that's going to come out of his. I never do. He's a cynical careerist politician.
Who would you fear in our next election as a leader of the Tory Party?
Darth Vader.
Who would I fear? Well, if we've got Corbyn at the helm, and I think, you know, he's a bit like Obi-Wan Kenobi. So he's striking me and I'm coming back stronger, so, I mean...
The thing is actually, you know, you kind of think of... At the moment, Conservatives seem like this kind of... Because of their policies, because of this last campaign. But you have to believe that there are Conservatives who believe in the country in the way that Jeremy Corbyn has convinced us that he believes. But at the moment, I don't see anyone in the Conservative Party that makes me believe that they actually care about this country.
I think Sarah
Wooderston, Heidi Alexander.
Who are the nice ones?
Well, there are the...
All women. Well, that's not a surprise.
Before we go to the break, we do want to show you the best and worst campaign video of the election. They are the same video. It's for Conservative MP and part-time musician, Sir Greg Knight.
I hope you'll vote for me and support Theresa May. We want a strong and stable government, not a coalition of chaos led by Jeremy Corbyn.
You get accountability with Conservative delivery. Make sure this time you get it right.
He won, by the way. He won his seat.
Right.
We'll be back with more of the Last Leg election special as we take a look at how London responded to last week's attack. And we want to know what the new coalition should be called. Tweet us at the Last Leg. Use the hashtag coalition names. We'll see you soon. Welcome back to the Last Leg election special. Where the tone of the election was altered by the horrible terror attacks in both Manchester and London. Our thoughts, as always, are with all those affected by the attacks, and even though it gets a little harder to believe this each time, we still choose love. And in times like these, we always say to look for the helpers, but this week, the helpers were helping the helpers. As Andrew Blevin asked, is it OK that Manchester Emergency Department sent pizza to London trauma centres during the London Bridge attacks? Yes, what an amazing... There was such, again, such an amazing outpouring of generosity and help and selflessness. Twitter was flooded with offers of beds for people unable to get home after the attacks. News outlets in America, though, described Britain as reeling from the attacks. And the British attitude was more accurately summed up by this photo of a man fleeing the attacks with a pint in his hand.
Thing about that, it's not even his pint, he's just grabbed it as he's gone home. It's another guy behind him with a wooden spoon with a number on it.
Like Pepper said, that guy was from Liverpool,
yeah,
and he's probably kind of thinking, fucking £6 a pint, I'm taking it with me.
I was in Ireland over the weekend, and when people saw that photo, they went, Jesus, if that was here, everyone would have a pint. One guy went back the next day to the restaurant he was in to pay the bill and even left a tip. And then the day after, there was a bomb scare in Cambridge. A restaurant was evacuated and one diner reported, and I quote, a policeman came down and demanded that everybody get out of the restaurant, so I grabbed my creme brulee and ran. Lions Bite said, is it OK that a lot of people now like some Millwall fans after their heroism on Saturday? That's because one Millwall fan apparently took on the attackers after shouting the phrase, and I quote again, fuck you, I'm Millwall.
the guy who did that, Roy Lana, I think his name was, first of all, he's an absolute, like, hero to, you know, selflessly put his body on the line, you know, to defend, you know, women and children in restaurants. But there is also part of me that thinks... He did see someone in an Arsenal shirt and thought, fuck this, not on my turf.
LJ Day said, is it OK that when you've been stabbed by a terrorist, your mates are always there with handy tips for the future? That's because the mates of the Millwall fan photoshopped him with a book called Learn to Run. Terry West said, is it OK that after saying we won't let it affect us, we are actually considering not coming to the Last Leg on Friday? Oh, it did... Terry West, are you here?
Yep.
Hey! You don't... Excellent. Well done for coming. And just to make you feel safe, we've got you a pint and a creme brulee.
Just with the pint, though, mate. I mean, we're still here for about another hour, so don't drink it too quickly, because you can't go out for a piss.
Thank you, Alex. Martin Rees said, is it OK that Trump took Sadiq Khan's reassurance out of context, then said Khan made a pathetic excuse? Hashtag back off Trump, hashtag...
You talk shite, hen.
After Sadiq Khan told Londoners there was no reason to be alarmed by the increased police presence, Trump criticised him. And when the Mayor of London clarified his statement, Trump called it a pathetic excuse. Now, this all came after Donald Trump initially reacted to the attacks by retweeting an unverified report from a website called the Drudge Report, and then also tweeted, do you notice we are not having a gun debate right now? That's because they used knives and a truck.
Somebody order a prick.
I mean, there is an argument to say we're not having the gun debate because guns aren't freely available here, so they weren't able to get hold of them, unlike America. Theresa May 5 times refused to condemn Donald Trump. She didn't condemn him. She said he was wrong, but she didn't kind of outright say...
That played out well for her at the election, didn't it?
Do you not just think with Trump, because he just tweets, like, a load of shit, and, you know, he'll look and it'll get, like, retweets and likes and loads of replies.
Yeah.
If he was just sat there one time with Sean Spicer went, here, this one's going to go big, and he got no replies, no retweets, no likes, and it was just basically just ignore him like a little twatty toddler.
Maybe we should just all unfollow him.
I'm not following him.
I think we need to respond to Trump, because here's the thing. We know that Theresa May didn't. We know that Sadiq Khan can't really. He's the mayor of London. He can't say what's on his mind.
He can't ban him from London. Oh, he could. That'd be great.
If I was Sadiq Khan, I'd like create like another, like a little sly account. Like back in the day, I had one called Billy Bellend, and I'd like people who trolled me, I'd give them shit via that on the sly.
He used to troll me, Billy Bellend.
Yeah, he did.
I tell you what, on behalf of all of London, I'd like to respond to Donald Trump right now by saying, and let me be quite clear about this, fuck off. First response to a terror attack in London was to retweet the Drudge Report, the journalistic equivalent of shitting into a box? How about my thoughts and wishes go out to the people of London in a similar way that Sadiq Khan did after the Orlando shooting a year ago? Maybe just butt out. Just butt out until you know all the details, you cheddar-faced scrotum. You know what? I'll tell you what'll leave Britain reeling. A state visit from you, you stubby-fingered dilettante. If you thought your UK trip was going to be rough before, try it now, mate. There are people booking time off work in order to protest. And in Britain, they protest in a very special way. When you get off Air Force One at Heathrow Airport, you're going to be faced by 60 million bare, freckly British arses. When you go through Hounslow, you'll see arses. When you hit Chelsea, you'll see pampered arses. You're going to see more bare arses than a weekend in a Russian hotel. But the thing is, I know none of this is actually getting through to Donald Trump, because I've been saying words in a row for more than 30 seconds. So, gentlemen, drop trowel now.
You may go. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you all. Thank you all. I won't shake all your hands, but a round of applause for our bums, please.
Can I just say...
What?
I've always wondered why he had MP on your arse. I just assumed you like Michael Portillo.
Tell you what, if I get you, they had a better angle than we did.
If I get drunk tonight and end up in Westminster with MP painted on my ass, someone's going to say yes. Unlike Donald Trump, one person who does have direct experience of what we're talking about, not the bums of the... This is awkward. is a member of the House of Lords who has written a book called The Enemy Within, A Tale of Muslim Britain. Would you please welcome Baroness Saida Varsi. Welcome to the show. We have been talking about the attacks.
Why did I agree to do this? Why? They told me I was going on Question Time.
Oh, there are way more bare asses on Question Time.
This is like one of those moments when your kind of new office mate say, do you want to come out for dinner? And you get there and you realise they're just waiting to kick your head in or something.
Oh, no. Oh, God.
There are some nice Tories.
I know. OK, you've seen everything that's happened thus far, I forgot. Exactly. It's been pretty...
Shouldn't have watched the show. That was...
are there nice Tories?
Lots of nice Tories. I'm a nice Tory. Well, clearly that didn't work.
let's talk about the attacks. And this is your book, The Enemy Within, A Tale of Muslim Britain. There's a quote in here I want to run by you. It's from Buffy the Vampire Slayer, which I love. It says, in my generation, there was a single girl given the strength and skill to fight the spread of darkness. Now, why is that appropriate when we're talking about, you know, the spread of terrorism and these attacks?
Because that is actually at the beginning of a chapter where I have an open conversation with British Muslims, and I basically say, my dear co-religionists, there are 3 million of you, us, we're not all terrorists, but are we fit for purpose? And I have quite a frank conversation about saying to the British Muslim community, raise your game. If, you know, we are an integral part of this country. I mean, my own story, you know, my granddad fought for this country in the Second World War. My parents broke their back in Yorkshire trying to create a living for themselves and others. And I served my country at the top table. And I'm sick of taking the loyalty test. I'm sick of taking the loyalty test, and it's time for us to say we are an integral part of this nation and we're going to play our part.
How do you mean by the loyalty test?
Well, the number of times that people keep saying, well, are you Muslim first, are you British first, you know, and there's a real suspicion about Muslims in Britain. They're seen very much, I think, in some quarters as the enemy within.
Yeah.
And I just think, how long before you're not the enemy within, you know, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, 60 years? How long before people just say, actually, you just... the rest of us, you're just part of the rest of society.
So what do you think Muslims have to do when you say they have to step up, they have to...
Well, I want to see a really vibrant, confident British Muslim community. Right now, it feels like, you know, there's a huge, ginormous LED spotlight that follows them everywhere. And I think they feel like sometimes a community in retreat because of the actions of such a small minority of them. Look, less than one-tenth of British Muslims, less than one-tenth of 1% of British Muslims will ever be involved in terrorism. You're more likely to meet a Muslim as your GP or in the NHS, and yet we don't go around saying, you know, those damn Muslims saving lives all the time, every day. You know? And yet, you know, we define them by these ad hoc life takers. And I just really hope that, you know, the book is about saying there's more to us than these crazy nut jobs who do these most vile acts in the name of the faith that I follow.
Well, back to the election briefly. What... OK. What now for the Tories? Because you you said something like anything less than a 40-seat majority was going to be a loss.
No, I didn't. I mean, I actually said that I thought we were going to get a 40-seat majority.
Oh, I see. OK.
But I mean, look, this isn't what we went to the country for. We didn't expect this. None of us expected this.
Yeah.
But 10 days from now, we start to negotiate the Brexit deal. And so what do? I mean, we have to go on governing. I think the worry I have is that we've just got into bed with some really interesting people from Northern Ireland.
So would you have not made that deal?
Well, look, we've spent years trying to detoxify the party and kind of convince people that we're not, you know, we're not homophobic and we're not anti-women's rights and anti-minority rights and, you know, we believe in climate change and all of that stuff. And then we just get into bed with this whole bunch of people that believe everything that we say we don't believe anymore. And I just think it's, in the short term, it might provide us with the majority, but I think in the long term, it's going to damage us.
Has Theresa May been a little bit quiet on the Tory WhatsApp group today?
Well, you know, having been on this programme, I ain't going to be on that WhatsApp group. No calls for me from number 10 tomorrow.
Do you think it was a bit cheeky of her to say, right, let's get to work, when she was the one that kind of created the distraction for the past 6 weeks anyway?
Look, Theresa has spent years and years battling within a Conservative Party. I mean, to be fair to her, she's had to spend years hiding her emotions, really just getting on with the job.
Yeah.
And I think that's what kind of instinctively comes to her, to say, look, let's just get on with the job, and that's what she said. And look, if she doesn't get on with the job, what are we going to do? Just sit back and not send somebody to this meeting in 10 days? Like, oh, really sorry, we're just kind of sorting out our mess over here until you get on with it and just negotiate and boot us out of Europe. You know, I just think we've got to get on with the job.
Back to what happened this week, by the way. The people of Manchester showed their defiance. Did you see the One Love Manchester concert on Sunday?
I did.
Absolutely amazing. 50,000 fans attended that concert. The day after the London attacks, people still came out in force. Simon Povey asked, is it OK that with cystitis claiming responsibility for everything, soon they'll be claiming responsibility for actual cystitis? Of course, the big revelation was that one of the attackers of the London attacks last week had featured on a Channel 4 documentary called The Jihadis Next Door. So it's kind of no surprise that he committed an atrocity. It's like being shocked that one of the Kardashians turned out to be an attention-loving exhibitionist. I think, you know, whenever these attacks take place, we always talk about what we can do as a community. We can come together, we can help each other, we can spread love, not hate. But there comes a point where the government have got to step up. Like, sure, what are the government going to do? Like, what can they do and what will they do? Because Theresa May used the phrase, enough is enough, which is a phrase that was used by people who had recently protested against her cuts to the police force.
I mean, like, because they cut the police... Well, did Theresa May cut the police down by
by about around 20,000, and there's around about 20,000 people on the watch list.
Yeah.
So basically, like, they could have deployed a man-to-man marking system.
Look, what came out really strongly in the aftermath of these three attacks was that, you know, one of the things that I hear all the time is, why don't Muslims condemn? And then you condemn and you say, well, it's not good enough. And then they say, well, why don't Muslims report? And actually, on this particular occasion, what we found with each of those terrorist attacks was that Muslim communities were saying, these guys are bad ones, these guys are radicalised, we need to watch them.
Yeah.
And so I think what politicians need to do first and foremost is, before we start announcing a whole range of other policies, let's go back and say, what could we have done in each of these individual three cases which could have stopped them from becoming terrorists? And it seems like obvious stuff, but you'd be surprised. The biggest challenge we have in counter-terrorism policy is that we don't actually rely upon what the evidence is saying. You know, we're just ideological about it, so we make these great statements about what we think is the problem without spending real detailed time about looking at the individual's lives of these terrorists and their particular journeys to terrorism.
And is that going to change, do you think?
Well, I hope it does. I mean, I've kind of communicated that back to the Prime Minister, and I've, you know, written about it, and I've written a whole damn book about it. So, you know, maybe if what we're really concerned about is the future security of our country, you know, what happens to our kids, then we've got to start getting it right. And that starts by going back to what the evidence is saying and what the experts are saying.
But, I mean, so you've written this book, and you can take that to Theresa May and say, here, it's all
I've sent
here.
Her a copy.
Yeah, but what if Boris becomes Prime Minister? He's not going to... I mean, you're going to have to draw in crayon. Like, listen, thank you so much for coming on the show and for proving that there are nice Tories out there. A round of applause for Tony Martin. Thank you. We'll be back with more of the Last Lady Election special as we bring people together with Jamie Oliver and Brendan Cox. Plus, we still want to know what you think the coalition should be called. Tweet us at the Last Leg. Use the hashtag coalition names. You might want to leave for that one. We'll see you soon. Welcome back to Last Leg, where it's time to bring people together. In the wake of the attacks in Westminster, Manchester and Borough, next week marks the anniversary of the death of MP Jo Cox. And to honour her, an event called the Great Get-Together will be taking place across Britain. To tell us more about it, would you please welcome Chef Jamie Oliver, along with Jo Cox's husband, Brendan Cox. Gentlemen, would you like a sausage?
No, thanks.
Probably.
Jamie told me I shouldn't eat them.
No, Jamie's right. Jamie's right. Always listen to Jamie. I might move them off here, otherwise they're going to sizzle for the rest of the show. Brendan, tell us more about the Great Get-Together. It is next weekend.
Yeah, so it's a very basic idea. Firstly, just from a very personal point of view, I wanted to remember Jo in the way that she lived rather than how she died. And she was someone that loved the party, loved getting together with her neighbours. And then secondly, Jo's murder was designed to... tear communities apart, designed to turn neighbour against neighbour, and we could think of no better way than saying fuck off to those extremists than getting people together, getting millions of people together to have a party.
Well put. Millions of people are getting involved. There are over 111,000 get-togethers, and you can get involved yourself. But if you go online, just search The Great Get-Together, you'll find all the details that you need. Jamie, how did you get involved in it?
I met Brendan up a mountain. We met for the first time. Joe's death last year was one of the darkest parts of last year, I think. It really bothered me as a dad. I think when I met him, I saw him sort of father to father, looking after the kids. And I think that what can you do apart from turn something awful and dreadful into something incredible? And the great get together is all of that. And I think in this time, with everything that's gone on with Manchester, Borough, and everything in that environment, like this whole looking at who is... like, it's about getting to know your neighbour. It's actually about getting to the person that maybe you've had a bit of a row with and saying, sorry, it's about a cup of tea. You could get a takeaway, even a dodgy one. Like, cook a barbecue, anything, but just sign up. And I think, you know, we do these things in the Jubilee. Like, when Britain does it, they do it mad. And actually, I think when we got together, it just
made sense. And, of course, from my point of view, food's just the excuse. It's just the conduit.
Yeah.
Right? And I think everyone that we've spoken to is on board. And yeah. Are you guys on board? Are you up for this? I really believe in it. And I think, you know, this week, actually, I was in an incredible project where a community come together, and it was through a kind of charity where if you're on benefits, you go to a special supermarket and they help you do budgeting and stuff like that. It's a bit like kind of what a job centre should be.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, what it does is bring all the elements of communities together, the ones that never talk to each other. And this is everything we're reading in the press. And they get them out of it. And I just think, like, it can work, and it's all around food, and I think it'd be amazing.
And to help kick it all off next week, we're going to be doing a 2-hour-long special of The Last Leg. It's going to be called Reunited Britain. We're going to be focusing on bringing people together. There's going to be a street party here outside our studios featuring live music from Elbow. We'll cross to a street party in Manchester. We're going to have a rotating roster of guests, and we're going to be using the hashtag MakeItOK. If you'd like to apologise to anyone, make amends for anything, or suggest people who should get together and smooth things over, just use the hashtag MakeItOK. You can even start using it now. Maybe there's someone you've been avoiding and really should patch things up with. Any suggestions?
Alex.
Oh, really? Yeah.
No, Noel and Liam Gallagher.
Yes.
Yes.
Because, it was a difficult one because, obviously, the person I felt most sorry for in that argument was Jason Orange. Because Take That played without him, no-one seemed to give a shit.
I'd like John Terry and Wayne Bridge.
Again, I was lost at Jason Orange. we're also going to be putting people with opposing views into a hot tub to settle their differences. It's called the Excusey Jacuzzi.
I don't want to see John Terry and Wayne Bridge in a hot tub.
I think George Osborne and Ed Balls actually came together last night in joy when the exit poll was announced.
What?
Oh, they even held hands.
Oh, I took that literally for a second. I didn't know.
we have an excusey jacuzzi. We've got it set up for tonight. This is what's going on in it right now.
I love the fact that they're still in their outfits. That's the best bit.
I reckon one of those lookalikes is going to be a lot busier than the other over the next few months.
What do you mean, lookalike?
Brendan, have you got anything else to add to what we've said about next weekend?
I think the only thing is, like, we've still got a week to go and you can do anything. We've got some huge parties. We've got a party in the Olympic Park of 10,000 people, but we've got lots of small things happening as well. And I think it's just that excuse. I think one of the things about being British is we love community. We love knowing our neighbours. But we're all a bit socially awkward and we need an excuse. And I hope this is just an excuse for people to get together on that weekend.
Well, listen, we'll kick it off next Friday. We wish you all the best for the great get-together.
Thank you.
And we'll do our best to honour Joe's memory next Friday as we do the show. Would you please thank Brendan Cox? We'll be back with more of The Last Leg in a bit as we mop up the dregs of the campaign and we want to know what the new coalition should be called. Tweet us at The Last Leg. Use the hashtag coalition names. We'll see you soon. Welcome back to Last Leg, where we are joined again by Jessica Hines, Richard Osman, Jamie Oliver, Clive Lewis, Baroness Varsi.
Yeah,
did I miss anyone?
Yeah, us two.
No.
You're always here. It looks like an amazing game of Guess Who now, doesn't it?
Jamie, what were your reactions last night to the election?
Probably the same as everyone else's. I mean, I've been a little bit outspoken amongst it. I mean, apolitically, of course, but because one of Theresa's manifesto things was to take away the school lunches for the infants, four, yeah, 5 and 6 year olds of Britain. So that kind of got on my nerves a bit.
Yeah.
And it was just a strange thing.
What did you make, Richard, in particular, of the SNP not getting as many seats as they made?
I think, you know what, SNP for years and years have been getting 1, 2, 6 seats was the most they had ever had until the last election, where suddenly they're over 50, 35. Is still an extraordinary amount of seats. Mm. It's one of those things that you've got to let the dust settle on that for a couple of years, and the SNP is still a very, very powerful thing, but you cannot follow up getting 51 seats. You can't do it. So I think for them, it's just going to... That's where they should be. Out.
It's like you can't follow Definitely Maybe, but they've managed it. Sorry, I'm still obsessed with this Oasis thing. I need to move on.
What was interesting was that the UKIP vote ended up being split between Labour and the Tories. Did that surprise both of you, Clive? And
No, it didn't surprise me, because on the doorstep there was a lot of UKIP voters saying to me, I get your manifesto. Makes sense. I understand it. I like it.
Right.
So that was something anecdotally, but that's what we were hearing.
I think it's one of the mistakes that we made. I think we just assumed that, you know, the UKIP vote would come back to the Conservatives, and it didn't, and it split, and I think that's where we saw the difference in what we expected.
I like Paul Nuttall saying that UKIP still has a big future. He said, we are the guard dogs for Brexit. If someone tells him that guard dogs are German shepherds, he's going to be furious.
The weird thing was, Paul Nuttall, as it turned out, had trouble actually even voting for himself because he was registered to vote 120 miles away from where he was standing because he was standing in a completely different area. He had to cast his vote at his home in Congleton in Cheshire before making the three-hour drive to Boston and Skegness, where he failed to become an elected MP. He has since resigned and has deleted his Twitter account. It now looks like this.
I saw a UKIP person being interviewed last night about 2 a.m. and they said, we would not go into coalition. You're like, you haven't got any fucking seats, mate.
I keep thinking that in a few years' time, I'm going to go into a Wetherspoons in the northwest. Bouncer's going to stop me and go, didn't you used to be the... you can't come in, mate. Oh, it was you.
Well, maybe that's why he's deleted his Twitter account. Because I go, no, let me check Twitter. I'll show up. No, it's gone. It's not there anymore. You have just deleted any trace. Is Nigel Farage going to return? Yeah.
Did he ever go?
Well, that's a good point. He's kind of... I've got a feeling the UKIP leader is a bit like the Doctor in Doctor Who, except that he keeps regenerating as Nigel Farage. Do you think he'll come back?
I don't actually think Nigel ever left. I think Nigel... The problem we have with UKIP is they all want to be leaders. And so they all get a go at it, as we've seen. They've all had a go at it. But then they all fail, and then they all leave, and then they all want to come back. And then they... And I just think it's... I think the one... Look, there were two good news stories of the night. One was that UKIP are finished, and I think it was obvious that they were finished. And the second was that we now have more women in Parliament than we've ever had before.
Absolutely.
And that's going to be brilliant.
That's what
I think UKIP without Nigel Farage is like Oasis without Noel Gallagher.
It was a bit like when he left, it was a bit like when E.T. goes and he kind of goes up to Paul Nuttall and goes, I'll be right here.
The saddest moment of the night, I think, belonged to Nick Clegg, who lost his seat at Sheffield Hallam, broke all out.
I've never understood the Liberal Democrats. Who are they? What are they? I don't get it. I've never got it. What is it? What are they?
And actually, I felt quite sad that Nick had lost his seat. He was one of the nicest people around the cabinet table. People don't realise, actually. I always used to think if we were ever on an away day and we kind of got stranded on a desert island somewhere, he's the only one that wouldn't chop your leg off and eat it if he got on.
Wow.
Do you like away days, like the cabinet, like trust exercises?
Yeah,
Teresa, fall back into my arms.
I thought you meant like away days, like football away days.
No, we just go to a different town and do exactly what we'd have done in London.
You are essentially saying that every other member of the cabinet would have chopped your leg off. That's Ian Duncan Smith, I agree.
He'd have chopped your leg off and then not given you any benefits. Yeah.
If I do chop your leg off, you can get a bit of work out of it.
You guys have got to stop this. You're just finishing off my political career.
I think it's only just beginning.
I can also say we've had two female prime ministers in this country. Third time lucky, that's what I say.
Would you?
Definitely not. Why would you? I mean, why would you want to live in a world where every aspect of your life is scrutinised and most of it is... And politics is a pretty ruthless space, isn't it? It's pretty kind of godforsaken, soulless place most of the time. And I just think, why would you want to spend the rest of... And why would you want to be... And why would you want to be the leader of any political party? I mean, why would you want to be the leader of the Tory party?
Are you sure you chose the right job?
Well, we felt for Nick Clegg, especially during this moment last night.
Jared O'Mara, Labour Party, 21,000...
Do you you know before you go up there? Did they tell you?
You do have a little bit of an idea about what's going to happen, yeah.
Right.
I felt sorry for
him. You can prepare yourself.
I felt sorry for him because what's he going to do now? He was going to go back to uni, but he can't afford the fees.
I think they're like the director then was just like, zoom in, zoom in. I think he's going to cry. Zoom in.
Jess said, launch a chat show called The Last Clegg.
Jess said, is it OK to be slightly disappointed that Lord Buckethead and Elmo didn't beat the Conservatives in Maidenhead? Now, along with regular and clearly eccentric Howling Lord Hope and Elmo was a man called Lord Buckethead. That's the lineup. That's... See if you can pick which one is Lord Buckethead.
Is she the one on the left?
Think, Garrett, isn't
it? The one in the red dress.
Yeah. Oh, you can't keep being mean to her.
Sorry.
What? No, we're talking. I'm good. Oh, okay, you're right.
For long enough.
Lord Buckethead stood against Margaret Thatcher in 1987 and said he stood in this election because, quote, his starship happened to be passing the Kuiper Belt when I intercepted a large number of Earth communications bemoaning a lack of effective opposition in your politics. His policies included a referendum on whether to have a second Brexit referendum, defending full face coverings, and bringing back CFAX.
I understand, because I've already taken my benefits.
We did ask Lord Buckethead to appear on the show tonight, and I'm not kidding, this is the message we got back for him. Thank you kindly for getting in touch and for considering me for your program. It is likely that by the time I would be needed back in the Earth capital, I will be, to pick a word I've recently put to frequent use, knackered. I hope you understand, and I wish both you and your colleagues the very best wishes for your transmission, even the little one with the curly hair.
Obviously, I'm not saying if you were in the Maidenhead constituency, you should have voted for Lord Buckethead. Mm. But what you should do is, when you get asked on the exit poll, say you have. So at 10 o'clock, they go, the news is, every seat is Lord Buckethead.
Elsewhere, Lib Dem leader Tim Farron went head-to-head with someone called Mr. Fishfinger. Yes, you heard me correctly. Mr. Fishfinger, who ran as a fishfinger. And he did that because a Twitter poll found 92% of people would trust a fishfinger more than Tim Farron.
So I've never been let down by a fishfinger.
Exactly. His policies were free fishing rods for students, free fish for NHS workers, unfettered migration for fish and a slew of marine puns. Would you? How do you feel about fish fingers?
I think it's a shame he didn't win. I'd love to have seen him be grilled on Newsnight.
Hey! Oh, yes, please.
I do love a fish finger sandwich.
Yeah, we all love a fish finger. Watch his outraged reaction when Tim Farron inadvertently got his name wrong.
Massive thanks also to James, Eli, and indeed Mr. Finger for their contribution to this campaign. I thank them for their campaigns, great campaigns, and it was a great exercise in democracy.
on the plus side for Nick Clegg, at least he didn't have a fella dressed as a fish finger next to him.
That would have made it worse. Jamie, you were very vocal, as you mentioned, about school lunches during the election. Why? What got you so wound up
about
it? Well,
I'm not very good at all this political thing, but I just think that if you put child health at the heart of every department of government, you're going to have an amazing government mm-hmm. and an amazing future, and the economy will be stable. And I just think when we've got some of the most unhealthy kids in Europe, you know, it was infant school. It was literally the youngest, most vulnerable kids in the country. 4, 5 and 6 year olds.
Yeah.
It polled at 12% badly for the Conservatives. So I don't know why they did it. But also, for me, because I know that system very well the last 13 years, and I've been through 4 prime ministers, the fourth wouldn't talk to me. But, you know, but the thing is, it's not about taking money from here and saving it there, right? It's not a choice. It seed-funded the whole system. Do you know what I mean? Like, if you go to buy a car, you go for a drive, right? And that is the first 3 years. It gives parents relief, it saves them some money, and most importantly, it keeps packed lunches away, because that's the enemy of school lunch system being great. It's the biggest franchise in the world. You know, 26,000 schools. You know, there's 4.6 million kids in primary school, and 1.6 million of those are having a free school lunch. And, you know, it just...
baffled me.
So why? What, how did you feel about the offer of free breakfasts that they were putting out?
But because they need that as well. Yeah. You can't take one and then not do the other. I mean, like, you got to remember, 13 years ago, when I did the school dinners campaign, there were standards for dog food, but not kids' food, right? Yeah. We've come a long way.
Did anybody here have free school lunches? Me?
Yes. Yeah.
I did.
As in, free as in the number three.
If you could have free, you would have free.
So, Ida, what was the thinking behind this?
I actually don't know. I mean, I just don't know why we thought we could replace it with breakfast as opposed to lunches.
Gruel.
I mean, I think it was going to be cheaper, wasn't it, to do it if you were going to do it via breakfast.
All I know about, like, I run restaurants for a living, right?
Oh,
The system that's in repair, yeah. It's 56,000 lunch cooks around the country. It didn't, you know, 13 years ago, it hadn't had any investment and love for 30 years, right? You know, we've done so well. There's amazing things happening around the country, and it's protecting child health. And I think, you know, what happens is those 3 years kind of seed fund the whole system, the multi-billion pound system. So to take that and do that, it will crumble the whole lot. It's 17,000 jobs now probably going to be lost because of this. Right.
And you've brought a demonstration along tonight to kind of show.
Well, I have. Well, here's the thing. Like, you can't swap a lunch for breakfast, right? Yeah. You need both. But the numbers that the Conservative gave, we've had a whole bunch of economists and special, clever people look at it, and it works out at 7p. Just 6. Under, 90. Actually. Yeah, 6.9p.
7p a breakfast.
Yeah, and they're never going to be able to balance that. So you know what it's going to end up. It'll just be supporting the companies and the rubbish and more sugar, and it ain't going to be balanced. So I have got a little demonstration of what it might look like.
Oh, OK, bring it out. Jamie, do you want to take it away? Explain what's happening. Yes.
OK. So, hi, everybody. Welcome to the canteen, or, as we call it, the... scam team.
Oh, edgy.
So, you know, do you like that? Crumbling, you see, just like the Conservative government.
You should have paid more than 7p for the sign.
So, I'm not... maybe someone talking.
Oh, here we go.
For me.
That's really why you're here. There we go.
So,
yes. I like the way you get a round of applause for being tall.
Thank you.
Come on.
Josh and Alex.
Actually, it's good to find a chair that's finally my size.
Whoa. I mean, we're much smugger in here.
So,
I feel like Richard Osman does every day when he sits down.
This is...
I didn't break it.
Oh, this takes me back.
So, look, based on the numbers, just under 7p per school lunch, I went to a random supermarket and got value stuff today. Right? And I'm not joking. What do you want? What do you want? What do you want to eat?
I'll have baked breakfast. Beans, please.
Baked beans? OK. Yourself, darling?
Egg, please.
Egg? OK. Yeah. So, on today's figure, we emptied the value tin. This is no joke. You got 12 beans for 7p. Yeah. If you don't believe it, count it and try it yourself. What, you have an egg?
Egg, please.
Right, this isn't standard. I did upgrade to free range because I don't like battery eggs, OK? That's quarter of an egg for you. Boys, girls?
Just kind of some fruit.
Some fruit? A little bit. We've got a quarter of an apple here, mate. Darling, you know what I'm going to give you?
I'm a Tory. I'll take whatever's left.
OK. I think you might want a bit of fibre. So we've got a little bit of Weetabix. You've got 8/10 of a Weetabix there, but you've got no milk, so get your saliva going, girl. but I mean, this is where we're at, and as much as that is a laugh, that is pretty legit. And maybe the government have some better buying power, but it ain't going to be much. And you cannot take that school lunch and replace it with that.
Richard, Clive, how do you feel seeing that?
I just think that sums up, to so many people, the absolute arrogance with which the Conservative Party attempted to win this election. It's just absolutely outrageous that... I mean, you can't even afford gruel on 7p. I mean, I just think that when they try to do that, and you add it with a dementia tax and all the other things that they put in there, Theresa May not showing up, I think the British people are like, we're not mugs, you know, we're not mugs. And I think that, to me, is just... It just makes me feel really pleased that we've done what we've done. And we've given them a bit of a slap to say, you know what? on your bike, we're not having it, and I'm quite pleased with the result.
Jamie, yeah. You know when I go back and we do the post-mortem about what went wrong with this election?
Yes.
Can I take this back for that post-mortem?
Please do. I can give you a whole host of things to take back if you want. Actually, a whole business plan for school lunches that clearly the team had no idea what they were talking about. And I think that, I mean, that's the thing. I've been, like, Theresa also ruined the obesity strategy earlier in the year, and I know what happened. Like, in that room, you can imagine what happened. Like, I've got this great idea, right? We're going to take the lunch away and we're going to do breakfast and we're going to make 17,000 jobs redundant. We're going to, you know, we're going to take something balanced and give you that. It just don't make sense.
I so, don't mean to be...
Have you just eaten the apple?
Well, I enjoyed it.
Do you ever remember trading school lunch? Like, if you... Do you remember the ice cream scoop of potato? Do you ever remember trading portions?
Yeah, I've got six beans, but I inhaled the other six.
I don't want them. Can I swap?
Yeah, I don't really eat egg, but I love it.
Saida, can I ask, are you going to fight the good fight when you go back to your party? You're going to take that little bit and you're going to fight the good fight for school lunches?
In front of this audience, what else am I going to say?
Come back, everyone. And do you know what? I think I've worked out why the government think people can survive on these cuts. Have a look at the breakfast menu for the House of Commons. It looks like this, OK? Now, you've got grilled kipper, £1.75. Eggs Benedict for £2.05. Like, it's no wonder, you know, the government think you can live off very little money. They think an Eggs Benedict costs £2. They live in a world where a gin and tonic is 50p. By the way, in 2008, compared to all of that, compared to that tiny little bit of food that you gave out, in 2008, the candidate for a walking heart attack, Boris Johnson, said his breakfast, his breakfast consisted of, OK, a cup of coffee with I can't believe it's not butter and marmalade on toast, and then said, I might even have some cold spaghetti or a chop or two if there is some left over from my kids' meal the night before. There are often birthday cakes in the fridge which I'll eat for breakfast. I mean, it's hard to believe Boris Johnson.
How many kids has he... Birthday cakes? What does he do, live in a house of 364 other people?
How's this? He said, at work, I don't snack apart from a few chocolate croissants mid-morning to keep the wolf from the door. How is that a snack to keep... If the wolf came in, he'd eat it. look at this. Does this look like the man who eats birthday cakes for breakfast? I don't think so. He later admitted to drinking vast quantities of... Yes,
Jess? I eat birthday cake for breakfast. Do you? Yeah. I mean, just to kind of try to keep this equal.
Right.
I feel like it's been very Tory bashing. I want to say...
I do feel like that.
I eat spaghetti for breakfast sometimes and I do eat birthday cake for breakfast. I'm just saying.
You don't have to worry. I have spent years and years as a Tory campaigning in mining towns in Yorkshire and they have prepared me for this one moment of fame, actually.
Boris later admitted to drinking vast quantities of Diet Coke. I drink a litre of it a day. The man is a walking food bank.
What?
A litre of Diet Coke a day. What does that do to your stomach, Jamie?
It rots the calcium in your bones because of the phosphorus in the fizzy drinks.
It also affects your compassion.
Hang on a minute. You just pop that in there. You never... How much Diet Coke do I smash on an office day?
Yeah, and I warn you every time.
No, you don't.
Yeah,
you
never
said it will affect my bones.
Yeah. No.
I said, there's no helping me.
So Boris Johnson might be our next Prime Minister. If his bowels are anything like yours after the Diet Coke, we're never going to see him. We'll be back with more of the Last Leg election special in a minute as Josh takes us through the last 7 days. We'll see you soon. Leg election special, where we're still joined by Jessica Hines, Richard Osman, Jamie Oliver, Clive Lewis, Baroness Varsi. What's the correct... I every time I say Saida, I feel bad. I feel like I should be saying Baroness.
Yeah, of course, you should be saying my lady. I'm from a good part of Yorkshire, I'll have you know.
Should I be on one knee?
But it's been a long time.
Now... Blushing. I'll be honest. No, here's what went through my head was, wow, that worked out. No, that worked out better than I thought. And then, oh, hang on, I've got MP painted on my ass. Now, Josh found during the week the best way to get through all the election fallout. For someone who likes drinking, but doesn't like having to refill their glass all the time. Josh,
what
would
a waste
you like
of time
to
that is.
Pass these out? This is called the Guzzle
that.
Buddy.
Do you want me to pass them out?
Yeah, if you
this
could.
This really, I'd list this as a game changer.
Are you kidding me?
Look at this. This is a new invention.
Is this for real?
Yeah, it's for real.
Baroness, I've got because I know you don't drink. I've got a water for you.
Oh, give her a drink.
Really works.
There's a couple more for Josh and Alex.
Oh, really?
Oh, here we go. Oh, I know really? Which one I'm having.
I'm going to make every party. Have you got Prosecco?
Yeah, I have, mate. Tell you what, it's a good job I didn't have these on Big Brother when King was on
it's just downing it.
You've seen if it works. It does work,
yeah. It's quite smoky, the wine.
Happy with that?
Well, it's a bit of a bad quality wine, but apart from that.
You are the ultimate champagne socialist, don't you?
I tell you what, when you're swigging from a bottle, but you're going, I think the wine's a bit off.
You know what? I said it earlier, I'll say it again. They said we couldn't fill 2 hours, we fucking managed it.
One of my favourite elements of the election was, I mean, we've talked about the way Corbyn supporters reacted to the media, but it was all summed up for me by one clip. It's perfectly illustrated in this clip from his final campaign stop in Islington.
But the real challenge is whether he can project the message beyond the people who will fill halls like this, whether they can give that ride a message.
The internet became... It was interesting, this election. The internet did become a powerful tool. Parties spent more on digital marketing than posters and leaflets. New technology, of course, allowed parties to target people on Facebook, depending on where they live, when they are most receptive to messages and what kind of messages like might convince them to vote.
Kind of pop-up ads, like...
Yeah.
You will not believe what Michael Heseltine looks like now.
Unfortunately, there's no rules for political advertising on Facebook, so no-one really knows how truthful all the ads were. Francesca Oliver said, is it OK that social media is full of false information being shared, trying to manipulate the masses? Excuse me. While all parties are now using social media, this election saw the rise of Twitter bots. Now, I'm not sure if you guys are aware of this. A Twitter bot is basically an automated Twitter account programmed to tweet, retweet and even like other messages and accounts. During last year's referendum, a third of all Twitter traffic about Brexit was most likely caused by bots. Brexit bots tweeted three times as much as Remain bots.
They're not actually Twitter bots. They're just your researcher who just does that all night. You do realise that? That would be, they've been kind of just retweet.
Well, how many of them? Because we were wondering, like, how many are bots and how many of your researchers going, oh, God, I can't believe I still have to keep doing this. And I guess the idea is that sometimes they target journalists because if they get enough targets, then it might actually alter the story.
Yeah, I've been getting a lot of abuse and there's a lot of Twitter bots out there. Why did I suddenly go Devonshire then? That was me.
I did some research during the week, though, into our Twitter accounts to see, because you can check how many of them are real. Alex, 95% of your followers are real.
Yeah, boy, fake leg, real fans.
Josh, 82%.
That's not bad.
I've got 67% real. I know. Do you know what's worse? Piers Morgan has 73% real. I am less genuine than Piers Morgan. Jessica, 97% of yours are real.
Wow, that's a surprise.
Richard, 95%.
Welcome to the club.
Thanks, man.
Jamie, 57%.
Ooh, really?
Almost half of your followers are bots, apparently.
Jeez,
but that's because Jamie's got like 5.7 million followers. Anything over a few million and suddenly they're all fake.
Of course, they're all going to jump on board.
Damn. Yeah, so what's your excuse, Adam?
Baroness, 78% of yours, for your followers are real.
Oh, great.
Clive, 98%.
Yes, get in there, Basil. Yeah.
Jesus.
Josh has been spoiling the ballots of the last 7 days. What have you found?
Would you like to see the least suitable person to review an exciting new ride?
Yes, please.
But as you can see, the ride has already started. You hear the music that we've been talking about, too, so... Now the doors are closing. Any faster than this?
us out at the end. Very briefly, we asked what the new coalition should be called. The Made Up Party. May and DUP, Made Up Party. Never mind.
Hold on. You know, the good thing about the DUP...
Yeah.
No.
Oh. No. I think probably the most popular, the Conservative and Unionist negotiating team. Right, that's all we've got time for tonight. Would you please thank our guest, Jamie Oliver? Richard Osman! Jessica Hines! Baroness Saeeda Varsi! I'm our co-host, Josh Whitaker! And Alex Brooker! Next week, we'll be doing our best to bring people together in a two-hour special called Reunited Britain, featuring a whole party of guests, including live performances from Elbow. Please get involved. You can visit the website, www.greatgettogether.org. But tonight, to end the show, we've seen the election result. Who did I miss? Did I miss someone in the goodbyes? Clive! I'm so sorry, Clive! Clive!
You just did us a Clive!
Genuine person here on a room on a couch full of people with fake bits. That's pretty good. Tonight we've seen the election results summed up in graphs, jokes and charts. We'd like to wrap it all up with a song, and while it seems like there are no clear winners from this election, all the main players are still standing and may well have to stand again in another 12 months' time. Thanks for watching The Last Leg. My name's Adam Hills. See you next week for The Last Leg Reunited Britain.
Shines from you, you wind up like the wreck you hide behind that mask you use. Did you think this will never end? Well, look at me.